That's the Allegro Miserere, isn't it? Or rather, the version I was brought up on. That's the quartet with the high Cs. But that's not really what Allegri wrote, is it?
No, not at all.
Not even close?
Not even close.
So, if Allegri came back now and listened to it, would he be able to recognise it?
He'd be really struggling.
Is it just the notes which are different?
The notes are certainly different, but it's not just that.
Uh-huh. The general sound?
General sound, completely different, yes.
That's not what we used to be told. What happened?
Well, it's a long story. So let's start at the beginning. In around 1630, Allegri set Miserere Mei Deus, which is Psalm 50 in the Catholic Psalter, all 20 verses of it, to be sung at one of the offices of Tenebrae in Holy Week in the Sistine Chapel.
And knowing that helps us understand what it might have sounded like.
Oh, it definitely does. In the Vatican, there were three choirs. There was one for St. Peter's, which is the Basilica. There was one for the Cathedral, St. John Lateran. And there was a third one, the best one, apparently, which sang only in the Pope's private chapel, which was the Sistine. And that was a college of adult singers, which was self-governing.
So no boys?
No boys.
And no women?
Certainly not.
So, how do you know all this?
It all started with a recording project over 20 years ago, which resulted in this CD, which you remember.
Indeed I do.
And since then, I've written it all up in this book, available from all good booksellers.
So, who sang the upper parts?
At the beginning, they were sung by falsettists. But towards the end of the 16th century, around 1560, we started to get castrati, and there were more and more in the choir from that date.
I have a picture in my mind of the Sistine Chapel. So where was the choir placed?
The choir was in the cantoria.
Oh, yeah, the name gives it away rather, doesn't it? So when we hear recordings with the quartet in the distance, that's wrong.
Yes, that couldn't have happened in the chapel. There was no place for that.
Mm-hmm. And how big was the choir?
Generally around 24. It was officially 32, but there always seemed to have been vacancies.
That's a small space, even for 24.
Yes, but on the other hand, you have to remember that on that big music stand at the front was the music. People didn't have their own scores. So that saves an awful lot of space. And also, most of the things that they sang were plain chant, which they would have known after a while off by heart.
I'd like to hear some music now, please.
Yes, I think it's time for that. We're going to hear the first verse of Allegri's original version of the Miserere for five voices. Now, as you remember, I'm sure, verse one serves for later verses as well, 5, 9, 13, 17, and the first part of 20. So the score we're looking at here is in choir book format, which means that the parts are separate, but it's all on the same page.
Oh.
That was lovely. But it's completely different from what we normally hear.
It is. And that's because in 1717, they replaced Allegri's five-part verses with a completely new setting by Giovanni Biordi.
And that's more or less what we hear now.
It is, yes. It's Biordi.
So Allegri's original was set aside and was never performed again?
As far as we know, no.
Why?
Well, I suspect it's something to do with the new Miserere written by Tommaso Bai in 1711, which was more elaborate, and so they wanted something which was a bit more similar to that.
Tell me more about Tommaso Bai.
I'm going to come back to him because he's really important in this story. What we can say is that at least 50% of what we hear now called Allegri is not Allegri at all. It's Biordi.
Isn't verse one usually sung by the whole choir?
Yeah, that's a modern thing. They didn't do that in the Sistine Chapel. The only thing that was sung by the whole choir was the plain chant verses, which was sung by all the tenors and basses in unison. Here they are.
That's another thing. In the version of verse one, which we just heard, your singers weren't singing exactly what was on the page. They added little twiddles here and there.
Yes, well, singers will be singers. They always want to decorate, don't they? And they do even more in verse three.
There they go again. Little ornaments all over the place.
Yes, that's the way this kind of music was performed. It's one of the many reasons that we can be sure that it was sung by soloists. These decorations could be complex, when they were called passaggi, but more normal was to sing a piece simply, but even then it needed some sort of gracing.
How do we know that?
There was an Italian writer called Luigi Zanobi who wrote about it in a letter in 1600. He says that even a piece sung in its simple form must have grazie, graces, and other decorative elements. They're there to draw attention to the music and sometimes to illustrate the text. And of course, it's more fun like that.
So there was no such thing as a straight performance?
Not in music like this sung by soloists, no. That's not what they did. Gracing was one of the skills of professional singers at the time, and the singers in the Pope's chapel were the best of the best.
Does this freedom explain how the Miserere could have evolved so much over the years?
Yes, absolutely. This evolution is what made its reputation, which was about how it was sung, not the notes on the page.
And those top C's that everyone goes on about?
That's also part of the story. In the end, the best singers did eventually sing top C's, but not in the place that you heard them at the very beginning of this video.
Ah.
I'll come back to that too later.
Okay.
Anyway, by the beginning of the 18th century, people were saying that the Miserere was so ornamented as to be unrecognisable, particularly in the four-part verses.
Why the four-part verses particularly?
Probably because they're set for higher voices, and so the lead castrato, who was the star of the show, was involved in them.
All right. I was told that no copies of the Miserere were allowed to leave the Vatican on pain of excommunication. Is that true?
There's no evidence for that, but it certainly added to the mystique. But in fact, it doesn't actually make a lot of sense, because what was particular about the choir and its Miserere was the way they sang it, not was what was written on the page. So if anyone smuggled a Vatican choir book out, it wouldn't show anything.
All right. Apart from the gracing we heard, was there anything else unusual or spectacular about the way it was performed?
Oh, yes. They had lots of little mannerisms, which listeners always noted, sometimes even complained about. I think it's time to listen to the first modern performance of a manuscript actually made by singers in the Papal Chapel in 1798. This is the earliest written evidence we have of the kinds of things they did. Here's verse 1, based, of course, on Byrd's revision.
All that sliding around on the reciting chords.
Yes, that was one of the choir's secret weapons, parallel portamento. They'd slide up and down in parallel, and it's all written down here.
Oh, wow.
Quite. We can't be sure when they started doing this, because this manuscript is the earliest written record, right at the end of the 18th century. But the chances are it dates back to the beginning of the 18th century, and it carried on throughout the 19th. In all kinds of music, not just the Miserere. And it drove some listeners, especially the more musical ones, up the wall.
As well it might. So Mozart must have heard it when he copied down the Miserere in 1770,
yes, absolutely. It's such a shame his manuscript has been lost. It could have told us so much.
Some people say that Charles Burney got the music from his famous publication in 1771... from Mozart. I take it you don't believe that.
No, absolutely not. Burney got some music from a friendly singer in the choir, and he got some from Padre Martini in Bologna. But his published version has no ornamentation at all, so it's clearly just a library copy, not one taken from performance.
All right. So what about verse 3 in this manuscript?
Yes, we have that too. Judge for yourself. Here it is. You'll notice that it contains the famous abbellimento that we all know and love, which shoots up to a very high note and then slowly makes its way down again.
Yes, that rings a bell. Although the ornament came in the first part, I thought it always came at the end.
Well spotted. I'll explain that in a minute.
Oh, I love the way there's so much expression in the singing of the text. It's like choral recitative.
Absolutely. Let me read you what Bernie wrote about it. "This piece is so simple as to make those who have only seen it on paper wonder whence its beauty and effect could arise. And it owes its reputation more to the manner in which it is performed than to the composition. The same music is many times repeated to different words, and the singers have, by tradition, certain customs, expressions, and graces of convention, certi espressioni e gruppi, which produce great effects, such as swelling and diminishing the sounds altogether, accelerating or retarding the measure at some particular words, and singing some entire verses quicker than others." So you see that expression was all, and that was what impressed the listeners even more than the decorations.
So, to summarise, by now, around the end of the 18th century, the five-part verses are by somebody else, and Allegri's four-part verses have been so decorated that you can't recognise them anymore. And yet visitors flocked to the Sistine Chapel every year to hear the Allegri. That's quite funny, actually.
I'm sure Gregorio would have been amused and flattered. What might have pleased Allegri particularly was that you had to come to the Sistine Chapel and hear the choir in which he'd spent the last 22 years of his life to have the Allegri Miserere experience, even though there was, in fact, very little Allegri left in it.
And people came from everywhere, didn't they?
They came from all over Europe and later from America as well. Rome in Holy Week was an obligatory stop on the grand tour, and one of the highlights, perhaps the highlight, was the Miserere in the Sistine Chapel.
Was the interpretation more or less fixed by now, say 1800?
Yes, I'd say so. It didn't move much in the 19th century. And the 19th century was also its period of greatest fame. Everyone who was anyone came to hear it. Mendelssohn came in 1831 and wrote at great length about it. His sister Fanny came in 1840 and also wrote about it. And then there was Ewald, Spohr, who fulminated about the parallel portamento, Berlioz, Nicolai, Gounod, Liszt, for a long time, visitors like Goethe, Ingres, Chateaubriand, Mary Shelley, Harriet Beecher Stowe, and many others, they were moved to tears by it.
How is it that everybody nowadays sings something so different from what the Papal Choir sang? Surely the Papal Choir itself should be the authority.
You would think so. And it is, as you might have guessed, a very long and complicated story, particularly the history of this version of the four-part verses, which put the top C in the wrong place. If I explain how that happened, I think we'd probably be here all day. So I'm going to leave this to be explained in a very good video by Elam Rotem.
Hello and welcome to earlymusicsources.com. My name is Elam Rotem, and today we'll talk about Falso Bordone, the Miserere of Allegri, and a most bizarre musicological error.
In this video, Elam explains how an English musicologist called Rockstraw more or less invented what we hear nowadays and what his particular mistakes were. As a bonus, you get an explanation of the compositional process of all these miseraries called Falso Bordone. 19 miseraries over 450 years sung in the Sistine Chapel, all based on this process called Falso Bordone. Now we're going to talk about why in the 19th century Allegri's Miserere was performed less often, hardly ever complete, even though that was what nearly all the visitors to Rome had come for and believed that they'd heard when they left.
Thank you.
Oh, I know that's not the Allegri, but it does sound eerily like it.
The similarity that you hear was part of the plan. From the early 18th century onwards, you could have heard this Miserere in the Sistine Chapel every year during Holy Week, and most people thought it was the Allegri.
Really?
Clearly. They fought their way into the chapel to hear it, the climax of their Roman holiday. So that's what it was. What we have to remember is that there were three Misereres sung during Holy Week because there were three offices of Tenebrae: Wednesday night, Thursday night, and Friday night. From the very beginning of this tradition in 1514, the choir seems to have prided itself on doing a different Miserere on each day. And of course, there were no printed programmes. And so the public, for them, whatever they heard, it was the Allegri. As a French writer later said, today it was his. But when it's not his, it doesn't matter. We heard it. You ask three people who are in the Sistine on three different days, and they'll all tell you that they heard the one and only, the unique, the amazing Miserere.
But presumably the Allegri was performed on at least one of those evenings.
Yes, at the beginning. What had happened was this. At the end of the century, of the 17th century, Allegri's was the favourite Miserere, but it wasn't because of the music, it was because of that ornament, the one we heard earlier, which rises up suddenly and comes down. And so if people heard a different Miserere which didn't have that ornament, they thought they weren't getting the real thing.
Oh, and so they were disappointed. So what happened about that?
Well, a solution was found by Thomas Zobai in 1711. He wrote a new Miserere, and all the four-part verses were constructed so the ornament can be sung to them. He made the harmony fit. Here's one of them.
So the choir had Allegri's Miserere for one of the three Tenebrae offices, mm-hmm. and Byrd's for a second. But what about the third?
Easy. They just combined the two together. They might do the five-part verses from Allegri's and the four-part verses from Byrd's, or vice versa, or some other complicated formula that they dreamt up. But of course, only the choir knew, so that was job done.
Now, you said that Allegri's version started to be heard less often over time. Was that right?
Yeah. I noticed quite earlier that the choir seems to have decided it prefers Byrd's version. And that's almost certainly because in Byrd's version, every verse is different. Remember, we noted before that Allegri's verse 1 serves for verses 5 and 9 and 13 and so forth. And the four-part verses also serve for later verses. Same music, but with different words. Whereas Byrd wrote a new setting for every single verse, just paying attention that in the four-part verses, the ornament would always work in the same spot. Nam propteria flagellatum produxit ad
eos. How could we know that the singers preferred Byrd's version?
We know that because of what happened in 1815, which was a very special year. Now, the first thing we need to remember is that the Pope's choir only existed to sing from the Pope. If he wasn't there, it had no function and it was disbanded. So in 1809, he was kidnapped by Napoleon's army, this is Pius VII, and he only came back in mid-1814. And so in 1815, the new choir director, Giuseppe Baini, had to prepare for the choir's big moment of the year, the three Misereres of Holy Week 1815, as best he could. So it's not surprising that for the first and perhaps the only time, the choir performed the same Miserere on all 3 days. And we know that because the French composer Ferdinand Hérold was there for all 3 days and wrote it up in his diary. We also know that it was the by that was given 3 times, not the Allegri. In the diary of the choir, the Diario Sistina, it was written that on the second and third days, by's Miserere was sung. So if we believed Hérold, it must have also been sung on the first day. In the diary, that first day, the Miserere is called the Miserere della nostra cappella, the Miserere of our chapel. So put all those things together, and it seems that for the singers in the choir, by's Miserere was now the Miserere della nostra cappella. And that's even more surprising when you think that the Allegri would have been far easier to prepare, as so much of the music is the same from one verse to another. But they were more concerned about variety. And you can understand that when they've spent about 3 hours listening to the sort of chanting that's been going on in the background while I've been talking here. Crucifige,
crucifige. So the Allegri more or less disappeared?
Not entirely. Occasionally it was performed complete. More often it was given in part, mostly with Byes. But there is a little twist, final twist of the story, which is that when Byes Miserere was given, verse 3 was always Allegri's, as if as a kind of tribute to the origin of the ornament and the fame of the piece. So here is verse 3 of the Allegri, sung in the style of the 1820s.
By the style of the 1820s. I noticed that some of the ornaments were different.
Yes. I made a reconstruction, which you've just heard, based on a series of manuscripts copied in the 1820s, and they're all based around Allegri's setting rather than Byes. Most of them are now in Germany and seem to have been made for enthusiastic amateurs who'd come to Rome on the grand tour and were keen to see the ornaments written down. There was also a big vogue for singing the Miserere in the early 19th century in Germany, apparently. So perhaps some of it was for them. Anyway, one wonders if they ever realised that they were being fobbed off with yesterday's hit rather than by what the choir now sang most of the time.
Now, we haven't talked about the top Cs yet.
Ah, yes. Thank you for reminding me. We have to talk about pitch. From the time that the castrati started to join the choir towards the end of the 16th century, the general pitch level the choir used seems to have started to rise.
Because castrati could sing higher than falsettists?
Yes, that was their main attraction, so it would have been silly not to use it.
How did the choir get their note since nobody had tuning forks yet?
Nobody really knows. Of course, there was no organ. There's never been an organ in the Sistine Chapel. And the choir always sang unaccompanied, so they were always free to choose their own note. Usually, apparently, it was the basses who were in charge of deciding the pitch at the beginning. But there were occasions when they got it wrong, and either they had to growl on in the wrong key, or they had to even sometimes stop and start again.
So how high did they go?
Well, it was a gradual process, but by the end of the 18th century, the choir was routinely singing pieces a fourth higher than written pitch. As was explained in the video about the bizarre musicological error that led to the top C we hear nowadays, that was because the phrase on which it was based was sung a fourth higher when Mendelssohn wrote it down in 1831. And what's really strange about the whole thing is that the musicologist Rockstroh must have known that, but he seems to have decided to pretend that he didn't.
Must have taken some quite special singers to go that high.
Yes, there was one in particular in the 19th century, the most famous castrato, whose name was Don Mariano Padroni. He was so appreciated in the choir for his high notes that when he wanted to leave in 1815, they allowed him to just come and sing with them at Advent and Easter, or Lent rather, and be absent for the rest of the year. He was the only singer who ever had this privilege. So he carried on like that, and he sang the Miserere every year until 1845.
And do we have any detail about his own abbellimenti?
Luckily, yes, because by now people were sometimes writing them down. And it seems, from what we can tell, that every year he varied it and made it slightly different. There's one really extravagant one, which we're going to listen to now, which he sang in 1824. We're going to sing it to verse 19. And before that, to give it some context, we're going to sing verse 17 in five parts, and then the plainsong verse 18, chanted by all the men in unison, on a monotone, in the way that they are reputed to have done it, in a loud and aggressive manner.
Thank you.
That wasn't a castrato singing that high note, was it?
No, it wasn't. They're pretty hard to find these days.
Indeed.
But we should never forget that it was largely their input which created the unique sound world of the choir. Its reputation depended on them for three centuries, from the end of the 16th to the end of the 19th centuries. And that's when the College of Papal Singers was finally disbanded and the castrati disappeared with it.
Any more developments to tell us about before that happened?
One very important one, not necessarily for the performance practice, but for the evidence that it gives us. In 1892, Domenico Mustafa, who was the last director perpetuo of the choir, star castrato, composer, wrote for the choir a manuscript of the Miserere as he wanted it to be remembered. It is, as we might expect, completely bis, except that Allegri's is verse 3.
And what does it show us?
Well, it shows us everything, really, in the manner of performance. He made a score and he made separate parts, and there's abbellimenti, other ornaments, also tempo, dynamics, phrasings, many, many portamenti, and lots of little instructions and advice for the singers and the director.
So who was singing the top Cs by then?
I'm glad you asked that, because it was sung several times by Alessandro Moreschi, the only castrato whose voice has been preserved in recordings. In any case, Mustafa's manuscript is as close as we can get on paper to an oral recording of what visitors heard in Rome for more than 200 years. Of course, there's no doubt in my mind that he set down for posterity a record of a very long and ancient tradition. So we're going to finish with verse 20 from that source, recorded by my ensemble William Byrd in 2000. I'm sure you remember singing it, Sophie.
I certainly can. And my goodness, how much you've unearthed since then. Thank you very much for sharing that with us, Graham.
Oh, it's been a pleasure. So, verse 20. Tunc acceptabis for five voices is the first half. And then in the second half, tunc imponent, we hear it first in Bai's version for double choir, eight voices, and then in Allegri's version for nine voices. This is the only part of Allegri's original creation which has never been modified and is still sung as he wrote it.